Hey guys, welcome back. Today we're just kind of taking an informal range day, and I want to play around with a few of my favorite firearms from World War I. Many times I find myself fixating on World War II firearms, and that's because they're still readily available, they're still mostly in pretty good condition for collectors, and it just seems like, you know, World War II is just a little bit more recent. People can associate with it a little bit more because the weapons were a little bit more modern. You know, we were seeing the transition from bolt actions into self-loading rifles and lightweight machine guns and all that good stuff. But World War I really was a very influential war, the Great War. And a lot of things were developed in World War I that would definitely influence how war was fought in World War II just a few short years later. So, during World War I, one of the most popular and iconic rifles would have been used by the British Commonwealth, and that would be the SMLE, or the short magazine Lee Enfield. And this is an example of one of those rifles. This rifle started off as the MLE, evolved into the SMLE. Some of the soldiers would have called it the SMLE. That's, again, pronouncing acronyms as words. And it's just a very robust, well-liked rifle from the era. It's chambered in 303 Brit, which is a rimmed cartridge. And here's an example of a 303 Brit cartridge. The 303 Brit would be used in both of the Great Wars by the British forces and Commonwealth. And this rifle would evolve to later versions. It's pretty much distinguished by, not so much here, a lot of this would remain the same in later versions, but as you move out towards the end, you notice that the wood stocks come all the way in, and you have this pig-nosed butt cap on the end of the rifle. You'll also notice it has the rear sight that's forward. It's not an aperture sight. Again, very common for World War I era rifles. The SMLE has a very fast action on it. When you fire the gun, weapon is empty. When you fire the gun, you'll see the striker fall. And then when you cock it and pull it back, you'll notice the striker still in the forward position as it goes forward. If you watch that striker, let me try to keep my hand out of the way, you'll notice it's cocking on close. That striker staying back, being held against the sear as the bolt goes home. All right, so it's a very nice smooth bolt action that was popular with the troops. Now, is it the most robust bolt action? No. I personally think that the Mauser action is a more robust action, and I think it was probably the ultimate evolution of the bolt action rifle in general before we moved on to self-loading rifles. All right, so we have a single 303 Brit round, which I'm going to go ahead and throw into the gun and fire it. And gosh, I haven't fired this rifle in forever. I wonder if it's on at 100. Let's make sure I got my sights properly set. Has a very, very precise sight picture. I'm gonna say it's a little bit high. All right, so when you pull the bolt to the rear, it ejects the spent cartridge. Now, almost all of these internal magazine rifles would be fed via stripper clip like I have here. Now, one thing about the SMLE, you'll notice it has this box magazine that's exposed. And despite the fact that the box magazine is removable, troops weren't issued magazines. They were issued rounds on stripper clips. The magazines were meant to be left in the gun. All right. So that was still one of those things that was changing. These are brand new clips. And of course, it's a rimmed case, which makes how you stack the rounds into the end block stripper clip very important. Now, you'll notice I'm calling this a clip. That's because this is a clip. It's not a magazine. It does not have a spring in it. It's not a self-contained feeding unit. It's meant just to charge a magazine, which is what I just did. Now you can see I have 5 rounds loaded. Now I can just go ahead and push the bolt home. Fighting me a little bit there. We have a mixture of Remington ammo in here, and I've never really cared much for that Remington ammo. It's 174 grain ball. Ammo's really tight in the chamber. Let's shoot this close popper. You know what? Looks like it's a little bit off to the right. Oh yeah. So you'll notice here on the front sight you have holes, and you can drift this front sight over. As you can tell by the condition of the rifle, this rifle doesn't get shot a whole lot. I think I need to do some windage adjustment. I'm hitting on the right-hand side of that target that's about 20-some yards away. So if I aim a little bit left, I wonder if I can hit it 100. And yes, I could. Basically, I just aimed on the left-hand side of the target and hit him again. You'll probably hear that ringing. So, very, very cool rifle. Very simple. You have a manual safety over here when the lever's in this position, the bolt's locked, and the weapon cannot be fired. Then you, to make it ready, you would push it forward, and then you could charge the weapon. Something else that's interesting to note is that you could put the striker down. I wouldn't recommend doing that because it'd be resting on a primer, but it's knurled, so then you can draw the striker to the rear to charge the weapon. And again, there's your safety lever. So it has that V-notch sight in the rear. Very, very nice rifle to shoot. A lot of fun. It's kind of big and unwieldy and long, which is typical for firearms of the era. Now I do have a Lee Metford. I have a Constabulary carbine that I'd like to show you guys maybe in a later video. It's a really, really cool piece of Lee history. And I have several other Lee rifles. We'll just have to break them out. Now, this video isn't going to go into any great detail of any of the guns we're firing this afternoon. I'm just giving you guys an idea of some of my favorite World War I guns. All right, let's go grab something else and do some shooting with it. Let's put the Smealy away. I've probably said this many times before, but one of my favorite rifles of all times that's a bolt action is the Mauser, but of the Mauser actions. The 1903 Springfield holds a special place in my heart. Now, this is a World War I type Springfield. This one is made by Rock Island Arsenal. And yeah, this is just a beautiful 30-06 example of a Mauser actioned rifle that the United States would have fielded during the First World War. It wasn't the only rifle that we fielded. We had other rifles that we did use as well, but this would be our primary fighting rifle. The rifle chamber's a 30-06 cartridge, which, unlike the British 303, is a rimless design. So we don't run into the rim stacking problems and things like that that you would have with a rimmed cartridge. For rifles that feed from magazines and machine guns especially, it's kind of nice to have a rimless design, which is why that's what we use primarily today in cartridges. But during the turn of the century, rimmed cartridges were still quite common. So the 1903 Springfield, as I mentioned, is based on the Mauser action. We were actually licensing from Mauser of Germany this action until we got into a war with Germany during the First World War, and they wound up on the opposite side of their own rifles, which wasn't uncommon. The Mauser action was a very popular action through both World Wars, and many belligerent nations wound up using them against each other. So our rifle was a little bit different than some. Our 1903 Springfield, the First World War rifle, had sights much like everybody else. We had the sights that would be capable of being ranged out to several thousand meters, or you have a shallow V notch here for closer in engagements, your shallow notch being right there. Up front, we have a very thin, very precise front sight. But that front sight is unprotected. And one of the other things that made our Mausers kind of special was the fact that we have this switch. Right now I have it in the off position. You can see that it says off. And what that means is I have 5 rounds loaded into the gun, but despite that fact, you'll notice that the gun is not picking up a round out of the magazine, because off means I've turned the magazine off. Now this is an old military doctrine that goes back to the turn of the century. And what would happen was U.S. troops would load the magazine of their Springfield rifle, and they would single feed the guns until given the order by an officer, an NCO, to fire from the magazine, at which time they would switch the magazine into the on position, and then it would be no longer required to single feed the rifle. You just run the bolt, and you could fire all 5 rounds that are in the internal box magazine here. And of course, this one has a 5-round magazine. The SMLE has a 10-round magazine. All right, you have your striker back here. You have your typical Mauser safety up here on top. And yeah, just a really, really cool piece of American World War I history. Yeah, these sights are on. So now you'll notice I didn't pick up a round for the magazine, right? Because I still have the magazine in the off position. The 30-06 has a little bit of a wallop to it. It'll definitely let you know you're alive when it goes off. All right, now what I'm going to do is flip this switch. Let's pretend that I was just given the order to fire from the magazine, and now the bolt drops back a little bit further, and look what happens. I just picked up a round from the magazine. Little bit low. There we go. Yep. I was aiming center of mass. I was going a little high. I had to aim at the belly and I hit him. So anyway, that's how the rifle shoots. And it is well fed from 5-round stripper clips. I have a few here. Mine are kind of junky, but this would be a stripper clip that would be used in a rifle similar to this to charge the rifle. And then you could resume shooting. Such a beautiful piece of work. Beautiful stocks. Just absolutely gorgeous. I really, really do love the 1903, in case you couldn't tell. One of my favorite handguns of history, and a lot of people are going to agree with this. Maybe you are a Star Wars fan and you love Han Solo's blaster. It's, of course, based off the pistol I'm about to show you guys. But the C96 Mauser really was a revolutionary firearm for the First World War, and it continued on being used even in the Second World War. The handgun, as C96 denotes, was actually designed before the turn of the century. So it's one of the earliest successful self-loading pistols of its era. And it would oftentimes be found kitted out just like this. You have this leather frog wrapping a wooden stock. The stock doubles as a holster for the pistol. And you would have a cleaning rod and belt loops. Sometimes you'd see them more over the shoulders. But it was an interesting concept in that you see here being used a stock with a pistol, trying to extend the range of the pistol so it could either be used as a handgun or as an intermediate ranged weapon. And that evolved very quickly during the turn of the century when auto-loading pistols were coming into being. But it's not the first time we'd seen it done either. Even back in the revolver days, people were putting stocks on revolvers. It wasn't anything new, but it was something that was really interesting to see carry over into the automatic pistols. Then, for the longest time, by World War II, you'd find some English high powers and things like that that had stocks with them, but they really weren't used in combat. They were kind of discarded and just used as handguns. And then by today, most people don't even think of putting a stock on their handgun and turning it into an SBR, but look what's happening most recently with B&T and the USW chassis for the P320 and then the USW-A1. What's old is new again. And I'm hearing some rumors out there that there's some military units that are considering using those types of weapons, handguns, basically with stocks on them, now made out of polymer, because it's more useful. They're lighter weight, faster onto target, can be carried in a holster on the hip with the stock easily deployed. So it's really interesting to see, like I said, what is old is new again. So I'm going to go ahead and take my Mauser out. Now this, the gun and the wood stock, which is number matched to the gun, are original. This is a reproduction. The leather, lasting 100 years, is a little tough. All right, this stock, you'll see there's some minor cracks in it. The stock's old. It dries out, gets old, but the stocks are numbered, and the number on this stock matches and corresponds to the number on the Mauser that's on the inside of the stock. To open it up, you push the button, it swings open, and inside you'll find your broom handle. That's a 7.63 chambering, 7.63 Mauser, and of course this is an absolutely gorgeous example of the C96. Set the stock aside. This gun, like many weapons of the era, fires from an internal box magazine, so you do not have the capability of removing a magazine and quickly reloading it with another one. This one feeds from stripper clips, but it has a 10-round magazine. You'll notice that the sights are graduated up to very optimistic 1,000 meters, and that would probably be something you would attempt to do if you had the stock actually installed on the handgun. And you guys are probably saying, wow, those are purple, the trigger and the safety, and even the adjuster on the rear sight all look purple. That's what the fire blue would look like. I mean, that's actually correct. This gun is in pretty much outstanding shape. It's a small ring Mauser. You'll find others that have large rings, and a number of them were made. There are even some that were made in 45 ACP. But anyway, I digress. So to load the pistol, I'm going to go ahead and cock the hammer, draw the bolt to the rear, and you can see the magazine now on the inside of the gun. Feeds from a 10-round stripper clip. There is a guide right here on the receiver, and it's worth noting how the gun works. You have the barrel and bolt moving rearward together with a locking mechanism on the inside. And here is the 7.63 Mauser bottleneck cartridge. Now, a lot of things can be a little bit challenging because the extractor is on the top of the bolt, and you have to get that extractor out of the way to get the stripper clip down inside there. So you sometimes either pull the bolt to the rear or fight with it to get it down inside there. But once you get it seated, you can push the rounds down into the magazine. And as you can see, loading a magazine into the bottom of the grip would be much easier. But now, because I've pushed that bolt back with the stripper clip itself and then pushed the rounds down into the magazine, when I pull the stripper clip out, the weapon charges itself. Okay? So now it's gone ahead and loaded itself. And I have a safety right here. Now this one is a little bit worn. You should be able to put the safety on, but you pull the hammer back just ever so slightly and the safety will go into the safe position. So you can tell that it's on safe because it's like blocking this space or appearing in this space between the hammer and the back of the breech, and your firing pin is right there. All right, let's shoot this little guy. It has surprisingly light recoil and it's a truly pleasant little gun to shoot. What's funny is it has Mauser type sights, like Mauser rifle type sights. And as you can see, the gun locks open on the last shot fired. It's really, really cool to shoot one of these. It's almost indescribable what it feels like. The recoil, it jumps, but there's just no real recoil to the gun. It's just a really, really fun little gun to shoot. Oops, I pushed around out as I was trying to push. Ugh. Sometimes it's just a little bit easier to draw the bolt back slightly and drop the stripper clip down into air. It's a little guide there, and then push the rounds down into the magazine and yank it out, and it charges itself. All right, I'm gonna go ahead and put the gun on safe, grab the stock, which slides on like this, and the stocks are just a little bit wobbly, but this is what it would be like to shoot the Mauser with the stock in place. Only had 9 rounds. Get a little bit of oil on my face here because I keep it well oiled. And then you just take the stock off, go ahead, pull the bolt slightly to the rear, push down on the follower, let it go home, put your hammer down, open your stock up, and now you can put your C96 away. Absolutely amazing piece of World War I and World War II history. And you can definitely see how something like this would change the nature of warfare, keeping in mind most people fighting during World War I were still using revolvers. This would definitely give you an advantage, maybe not so much in the reloading department, but definitely gives you an advantage in that you have 10 rounds on tap, 11 if you want to top the gun off. Pretty cool. All right, so what would a World War I firearm video be without the 1911 handgun in it? The 1911 was easily the best military sidearm of the war. And I would argue it was probably the best military sidearm of World War II as well. But the gun did go into service in time for our involvement in World War I. Now, this is a very early 1911. This is not an A1. And you can tell that by a number of features. This still has its original wooden diamond grips, which are worn slick. This is an original Colt. This one's documented. It's an original Colt upper and lower. All numbers match. The rear mainspring housing is smooth and flat. If you take a look at the other side of the pistol, see the little Colt pony back here. Has the correct 1911 controls. And again, those well-used and worn grips. And then the Colt markings, and it's in its original finish. It's never been refinished, and it's never had the updates done to it for the 1911 A1. Now, the gun made it through the entire First World War. This gun would have been made late. I think it was made early 1918, if I'm not mistaken. So it was just in time for the end of the war for the United States involvement. Then it went on to serve in World War II, and the soldier brought this home from World War II. What's amazing about this gun is the fact that it's completely unmolested in its original World War I configuration with all of its original Colt parts. And that makes this a highly collectible handgun. Everything in here is original, and shooting it, of course, I run the risk of breaking something, and so I'm not going to shoot it a whole lot. All the springs, everything's original. It even has its original correct magazine, and yes, the two-tone is correct. We have some Winchester white box ammunition. It's from our friends over at LAX Ammo. There's a 3% discount code down below. They donate ammunition to the channel. The code down below does not get us any money. It doesn't earn us a paycheck. They don't pay us for using the code. It's just a thank you to you guys. So anyway, here we go. We're going to shoot this old girl. Load it up. Magazine fed from the bottom. Of course, this would become the standard by which all other handguns would be measured, even to this day in 2018 when this is being filmed. And most of the handguns that you find to be so fascinating and so modern and so new, like the Glock or the Smith & Wesson or guns like that, the CZ-75, the P10C, all base their actions off John Browning's original work in the 1911 handgun. I mean, guys, this old girl still has it. Original springs, everything, and the gun runs really, really well. I have some more ammunition in my pocket. Yes, I'm handling it delicately. I mean, I could probably kick it around and I'm not gonna hurt it, but I mean, it's such an amazing piece of history. And I do kind of sort of feel guilty about shooting some of these things because, again, if I break a part, I have to replace it, and then it loses its 100% authenticity and original components. Put 7 more rounds through it, keep our fingers crossed that I break nothing, just so you can see this classic piece of U.S. military history in action. I'm going to go ahead and take the safety off, lock the slide to the rear as if it had just become empty. And what's funny is it's not a complete rattle trap. The gun is in really, really good condition despite the fact that this patina has taken over. And the bore is nice and bright. The magazine spring is kind of bad. Nose dove on that first round. Again, it's the original magazine spring. And it has the notorious hammer bite. I can feel that every time. All right, not pushing my luck anymore. Hope you guys enjoyed seeing this beautiful, beautiful piece of U.S. military history. A Colt original 1911. That's what this is all about for me, guys. Yes, I love all the modern stuff just as much as the next guy, but touching this history and shooting it, knowing that this has seen battlefields and some soldier slept with this and used it to defend themselves and defend our nation, to defend our liberties. It's almost one of those things, it's overwhelming, gives you goosebumps. And that is one of the many reasons why I belong to the firearms culture. If you guys watch the channel, you know I just had to break out a Luger. Yes, the Luger is one of my favorite World War I handguns. This one is a 1916 DWM, and it's a very unique handgun. I mean, it just encapsulates the design of the era. I mean, it's more than just a handgun. It's a work of art in its design. It's based on an earlier gun called the Brochart, but if I could get my hands on one of those, I'd have to sell my house. They're incredibly expensive, but it had a very similar toggle action that had this big bulbous thing that hung off the rear, but ultimately evolved into the Luger that we know and love. Now, this is a 1916 built handgun, so again, this one would have served in World War I. It is chambered in 9mm because it is a German military service handgun, but the Lugers were adopted by a whole multitude of different nations, and some, like the Swiss, would have used the 30 Luger chambering, and the 9mm would have been something that the Germans used. Most Lugers will be, military Lugers will be, in fact, 9mm. And there's a whole bunch of different designs of Lugers, even within the German military. Of course, they were used in both World Wars. This one would have, of course, like I said, been used in World War I, but they would have had naval Lugers that would have a stock on them. This one's stock cut as well. You have artillery Lugers that have longer barrels and sights forward of the breech, and again, cut for stocks. I mean, just a whole bunch of different Lugers out there in different calibers. But the Luger has become known as just an iconic military service handgun. Now, despite the Luger being a very popular handgun, the toggle action just really didn't take off. Can you guys think of any other major popular military handgun after the Luger that used the toggle action? Yeah, the reason being is despite, and I've said this before in other videos, despite the in-range TV mud tests, which don't really tell us a lot, even our gauntlet tests, I tell you guys, don't mean much, they're more or less for entertainment. The Luger breezed through it, but anybody that collects and shoots Lugers knows that they're very finicky handguns. They can be very ammo specific, and they need to be maintained and kept in good working order. It's just, by today's standards, not a very good handgun. Now, by 1900 standards, man, this thing was as technologically advanced as you could get. Uses an 8-round magazine, feeds from the grip itself. You have the toggle action, and your safety is right here. The gun's on fire, and they're just pure pleasures to shoot. Amazing, amazing pistols. And there we go. We're going to start right off with a malfunction. This is Federal ammunition. I didn't bring out the nice hot stuff that keeps this gun running 100%. Ah, and she didn't lock open that time. The magazine springs, guys, go bad. And the magazines, many times the magazines are numbered. I don't know if this one's matching with the gun. I have a couple Lugers that have the actual correct magazines with them, but the magazines can range from $130 to $200 to $300 just to buy an original replacement magazine. Meggar makes replacement magazines, and the spring tension is very critical, as is using the right ammunition. You notice we had that malfunction there at the beginning. I am using, let's lay this down here. I am using Federal ammo. It's 124 grain ball. I'm gonna load the magazine up here one more time and see if we can get the old girl. Magazine's also feeling a little bit dry. Has a very steep angle to it, and the rims are dragging on the back, creating a lot of friction, and requires a very, very stiff magazine spring. And as that magazine spring weakens, the reliability of the gun goes down because the toggle action on the Luger is extremely fast. The lock time is extremely fast. And so everything has to be in perfect working order for the gun to function optimally. All right, I think I can get one more round in the magazine there. To reload it, we notice locked open, last shot fired. I'm gonna go ahead and insert the magazine, just grab the toggle, pull it rearward and let it go. And let's see if we can get it running. If it jams, again, it'll definitely be magazine related. Yeah, she's not locking open, but that's just the old magazine spring. Anyway, yeah, gosh, I really, really love these guns. I have some in better shape than others. I have shooters. This is one of my shooters, but just outstanding firearms to go out and have, you know, a nice Saturday afternoon with, relive some history. Guys, if you'd like to support us here on the Military Arms Channel, the best possible way to do that is to become a Patreon supporter. We don't take any money from the industry. We don't do videos where we get paychecks from gun companies and all this stuff and, you know, do advertisements. That's just not what we do. We're consumer advocates and we're doing something different. And that is, we ask that you support us on Patreon so that we can remain objective. And we do talk about new products and stuff like that. So consider following the link down below, follow that link, which is patreon.com, and consider clicking the Become Patreon button. Another great way to support us is to swing by our online t-shirt store, which we also have hoodies and sweaters, and we got some cool holiday stuff coming up. Swing by there, follow the link down below, pick up a shirt, pick up a sweater or a hoodie, and it directly supports us here at the channel. And last but not least, please swing by and check us out at Copper Custom, which is our online store. Guys and girls, thank you for 10 years of support, and we'll talk to you guys soon.